a fungus going around that infects you without you even knowing. Two, as far as we know, the fungus is everywhere, even in your backyard. Three, the fungus eats you from the inside out and eventually gets into your brain and controls how you move, and it forces you to infect others. Four, it can only infect flies.
Wait, what? Oh. Can only infect flies, not humans? What am I hiding for?
Yes, there's a zombie apocalypse going on right now all around us. Luckily for us, we humans can't get infected, so we don't have to worry about Night of the Living Dead anytime soon. My name is Julius, and I'm a graduate student in the Elia Lab. I and my fellow zombiologists study a fungus named Entomophthora musci. The name comes from ancient Greek. Entomophthora is from two roots, entomo, meaning insect, and thor, meaning destruction. In other words, it's the insect destroyer. Now, what insect does it destroy, you might ask? Well, the second part of its name, musci, means fly. Now, when most people think of fungus, they think of mushrooms, which doesn't seem really intimidating to me. So how did a fungus become known as the terrifying, zombie-making destroyer of flies? Well, our current understanding of the life cycle is this. A fungal spore lands on a fruit fly and burrows inside. The fly heals its wound and goes about its usual business with no idea what's about to happen to it. The spore begins to consume the fat body of the fly, which is an insect organ that stores its nutrients. You can think about it like our fat. As it gets energy, the fungus begins to grow, eating more and more of the fat body and filling up the fly. This gives it a distinct white belly. The fungus doesn't want to kill the fly or it'll die too, so it avoids eating the vital organs. However, the fungus can't stay in the fly forever. Once it starts to run out of food, it needs to leave the fly and infect a new host. But how does the fungus make sure it has the best chance of spreading the infection? Entomophthora musci needs to have a spore precisely land on another fly. Now, if you've ever tried to swat a tiny fly, you know they're famously a difficult target to hit. Now imagine trying to hit the fly with the head of a pin instead. Think about it for a second. How would you do that? Well, maybe you think it would be a good idea to take multiple shots, hoping that one out of the bunch hits. Or maybe you think firing at high speeds would be able to hit a fly before it can move away. Entomophthora musci does both of these things. It makes lots of spores, so it has lots of chances for one to hit, and it fires its spores using a high-pressure water cannon mechanism, so the spores can hit fast-moving targets. However, there's still a problem. Flies can just, you know, fly away. That's why Entomophthora musci needs to make its hosts into zombies. For the zombies we see in movies, they usually transmit their infection by biting the next person, so it makes sense that the zombie virus would want to control the minds of infected people to chase the uninfected. Entomophthora musci's fly zombies have a different behavior. During infection, some fungal cells move into the brain of the fly. Then, the fly loses control of its actions. The fly climbs upwards in a behavior called summiting. It reaches a high vantage point, sticks its proboscis, which is its mouth parts out, latches on to wherever it is, raises its wings, and then dies. The fungus then emerges from its back and rains spores down on unsuspecting flies, and it starts the cycle over again. In the Elia lab, we study how Entomophthora musci infects flies and turns them into zombies. What I just told you may sound like a complete story, but we still know very little about the mechanisms of infection. Yes, the fungal cells are in the brain, but how does that actually change the fly's behavior? What parts of the infection process are necessary for flies to be controlled as zombies? How did the fungus evolve to cause such a striking behavioral change in the flies? If you have a question about this fungus, odds are we still don't have the full answer. That makes zombie flies a really cool system to study. To do this, we have a constant infection going in little cages, putting unfortunate uninfected flies into an enclosed space with some zombies. Then, we can always have infected flies even when the zombies die. We use complex imaging to see fungal cells at high magnification, and we make genetically modified flies, including ones with neurons that light up when activated, so we can see how they respond to the fungus. We also measure chemicals in the fly's blood when the flies summit to see what signals the fungus might be using to manipulate the fly to move. We also use machine learning to track hundreds of flies at the same time and see which ones summit and how. But you don't need to do any of this to investigate zombie flies. Just go outside to your backyard and there very well may be a zombie fly there. Looking closely at it and asking some simple questions might let you notice something that no one ever has before. And if you've ever dreamed about being a hero during the zombie apocalypse, or if you're just curious, I hope I've convinced you to keep your eyes peeled next time you're out on a walk. There might be zombies out there.